Okay, if I can call this meeting to order and welcome you to the fourth meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in 2017, can I remind members and others in the room to switch phones and other devices to silent. And if we can move to agenda item one on continued petitions, and we're taking some evidence on petition 1605 by Peter Gregson on behalf of Kids Not Suits on whistleblowing in the NHS, a safer way to report mismanagement and bullying. At our last meeting, we heard evidence from City of Edinburgh Council, Public Concern at Work and Unison Scotland. This morning, we have the Director General of Health and Social Care and the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland, Paul Gray, to give evidence. Mr Gray is accompanied by Shirley Rodgers, Director of Health Workforce and Strategic Change from the Scottish Government. Can I thank you both for attending this morning? We've also had a number of issues raised at our previous session, so I would suggest we move straight to questions from the committee. And perhaps if I can start by asking for your views on the level of understanding about the purpose of the whistleblowing helpline, and can it be conflated with raising a grievance, and is that an issue for the organisation?
Thank you, Convener. I'll begin the answer and then ask Ms Rodgers to fill it out. And we're happy to take your guidance on length of answers. The awareness of the National Confidential Alert Line, I am certain, could be improved. There's no circumstances in which I would say that it was perfect, but I think the awareness is fairly broad. It's certainly known about by all of the boards and by the employee directors on the boards who, of course, represent the interests of the trade union side of the partnership. It's something that we seek to make staff aware of through a number of routes. The other part of your question was whether this could be conflated with grievance. And of course, a grievance is a matter which I understand in law needs to be dealt with between the employee and the employer. So to that extent, if someone phones the National Confidential Alert Line and expresses a grievance, then it would be referred back to the employer. If there were other aspects to their concerns, of course, that's not the only route that the National Confidential Alert Line can take. It can also refer matters, for example, to Healthcare Improvement Scotland, and it has done so. If you would like more detail from Ms Rodgers, we can provide that.
I think the observation I would make is that I think there are issues where those two things come together. I think by the very nature of people feeling aggrieved at work and having issues of concern, sometimes those things are not easy to separate out completely. So I think there are times when those matters have to be taken as a whole. And sometimes, depending on the response to the whistleblowing issue when it's raised, that can lead to employees having a sense of grievance or feeling that they have not had those matters dealt with in the first instance in the manner that they would have wished. So I think as a general principle, when people are feeling unhappy about something, it is sometimes possible for those issues to become conflated. There's a lot of work happened in respect of raising the awareness of the line. So Public Concern at Work, for example, have attended the NHS staff conference and had small pocket-sized guides to the line issued, and various other bits of materials have arisen. And I think the honest answer to your question about awareness is that that awareness has grown over time.
So is there an issue then, or where is the judgment that somebody feels they've been asked to do something that may be to the detriment of the service itself? So it's about them as an individual, but they're actually flagging up something broader and they're concerned to protect their own, you know, that they don't want to be identified in case this creates greater problems for them. What advice would be given to that person in those circumstances?
Well, it would depend on the nature of their concern. So, for example, if it was a concern about a clinical matter, then that must go through the appropriate clinical governance. Otherwise, we would be breaking the chain of accountability. It's probably difficult to answer the question without a specific example. And I'm more than happy to take any specific examples. I'm not trying to dodge the question, but it very much depends on the facts and circumstances of the individual case. If what you're prompting me to think about is a situation where a member of staff may be concerned about their immediate line management, for example, and therefore, to be simple about it, be afraid of what might happen next, we would certainly be urging in all circumstances staff to contact their trade union representative or other appropriate representative. There is escalation available in board governance, and ultimately, of course, there is a whistleblowing champion now on the board to whom matters can be addressed. Does that answer the question?
No, that's fine. Rona McKay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. At a previous session of this petition, the Chief Executive of Public Concern at Work indicated that she didn't agree with the aims of the petition, but noted that what is called for within the petition is not within the terms of the current contract for delivery of the National Confidential Alert Line. I wonder if you could maybe give me your views on that.
So I think what Public Concern at Work were referring to was the matter of an independent assessment of a case, and that's why we, in the consultation that we've done, the proposal of an independent national officer has been put forward, and the favoured option in the consultation was that independent national officer role should rest with the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. Now, clearly, ultimately, that would be a matter for the Scottish Parliament corporate body. But to be very straightforward about it, there is a recognition that an ultimate recourse to an independent national officer is something worth having.
Is that a recognition within the health service or just generally?
Well, by me as the Chief Executive of the National Health Service, by ministers and Director of Workforce. Mm-hmm. So, yes, I mean, we agree that is something that ought to be put in place.
And how likely is that to be put in place?
Well, I'm very clear that it should be. Ministers are very clear that it should be. It is, of course, as I say, ultimately a matter for the Parliament to agree, given that it would be a role for the Public Services Ombudsman if the Public Services Ombudsman was content to take it on. But we are working closely with them on that. I am both confident that we should establish an independent national officer and would be very disappointed if we did not.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Can I first of all declare an interest? I was the past chairman of the Argyll and Bute Integrated Joint Board, which I stood down from in August last year. ladies and gentlemen, the Scottish Government submission in October confirmed that the contract had been extended until June this year to ensure continuation of a cost-effective service. In light of the most recent six-month review for the period August 2015 to January 2016, which reported a 75% decrease in the number of calls to the helpline since it's established, can I ask for your views on whether this is not just a cost-effective service, but an effective and trusted service?
Thank you. If I might respond to that, we're on record as committing to an ongoing call line as part of the remedies available in respect of whistleblowing across the NHS. We're not committed at this stage to PICO or any individual supplier in that process. That contract comes to an end in June, as you've identified, and we will undertake the normal procurement processes in that space to look at who else might be able to provide that facility for us. We receive six monthly reports from PCOR at the moment, and as you say, some of the usage numbers are of interest to us. I think one of the important messages for the committee to hear is that whilst the National Confidential Alert Line is an important part of those remedies, it is only one part of those remedies. So we've been working for 2 or 3 years now on the implementation of the NHS Scotland Workforce Strategy. The first component part of that strategy is around values and culture. We are now receiving some indications that those values and that approach to the culture of patient safety and various other aspects are starting to be embedded in NHS board activity. So we have some support in that space. the policies and procedures, PEN guidelines that some of you may be familiar with, that we have established across NHS Scotland are also starting to give us a more consistent approach to how this is, how these kinds of activities are rolled out across Scotland. So I think your point is well made in terms of people, whether or not people are actively using the alert line. I don't think that's the only indicator of the sort of temperature and whistleblowing culture or support. I'd be very honest in saying I think there is still much more that we need to do about how the service is aware of the facilities and remedies that are available and about how consistently well those processes are brought to bear when they're required.
Brian Whittle.
I think following on from that question, there does seem to be some concerns about the effectiveness of the current helpline facility. Indeed, issues around low usage and lack of confidence in the system have been widely reported in the media, including your piece in the Herald in September last year. What sense do you have of whether confidence has increased among staff in recent months, and how do you measure or assess staff confidence in the system? I suppose you mentioned culture. Do you agree that we need an open learning environment in the NHS when things do go wrong, and that people do feel able to come forward?
Well, so there's a question about confidence in using the service, and as Shirley Rodgers has said, the other remedies that are available. I'll take that first, and then the point about an open learning culture. Every year, boards have an annual review, and sometimes that is a ministerial-led review and sometimes led by officials. And at that annual review, the ones I attend, there is always an opportunity to meet the partnership forum. And that's one of, by no means the only, mechanisms whereby we hear direct from the partnership how staff in that board are feeling and issues that they wish to raise directly with the minister or with me. And my sense is that there is a degree of confidence in these arrangements, but I think, as I said earlier in response to the convener, of course we could and are make sure that it's more widely known about and understood. The other point, which the data it's hard to interpret but may suggest, is that the spike in calls at the beginning was because people had a bottled up set of issues that they felt they had nowhere to go with. National Confidential Alert Line met that need, so the reduction in calls may not actually indicate a reduction in confidence or loss of confidence in the system itself. Before I come on to the point about an open and transparent culture, it may be that Shirley Rodgers would want to add something to what I've said.
I think it's very difficult for me to sit here and say that everybody is confident in something. I think people's confidence depends on the response that they receive and how closely they feel that that response addresses the issues that they've raised. We started this evidence with a question about conflating issues, and sometimes it's impossible to be able to separate those out for people in a way that is as optimal as they would wish us to be. And sometimes issues are raised that are appropriately dealt with, and sometimes that response is not always as optimal as it should be. I think it's also fair to say that we have put a great deal of investment, and with some external validation of that process, in partnership working in the NHS in Scotland and in our staff governance arrangements. And whilst I think that has taken the agenda forward a good deal, I think it's also fair to say that for some individuals, that in itself is not helpful to them. Sometimes the relationships between individuals and their representatives are not ideal. So I'm not going to say here that I think that system works perfectly every time. I think there is a huge investment in making people aware of whistleblowing. It's not something that was talked about in any setting 10, 15 years ago. It's something where there is increasing awareness. There's increasing awareness of what works in being able to address whistleblowing. There's increasing awareness of the effectiveness of listening. Actually, and quite often individuals are looking for is a process in which they feel that they have been respectfully, appropriately and considerately listened to. And I think that's something which we are building in terms of our leadership development capacity, our whole approach to how a modern NHS is managed, how people experience the workplace. So that's something that I think we have got demonstrable evidence, some of it externally validated. We've had a report into partnership working in the NHS through the University of Nottingham, who were very complimentary about the work that had taken place, but even in that recognises that there's still more to do. And as we continue on this journey, we are continuously trying to improve that situation and to learn from it. I think the other thing that I would add into that space is that whilst that activity is taking place in the board, I think we also in policy terms, so it's my pleasure and sometimes with some sadness, my role to meet frequently with people for whom the system has not always worked as well as we might wish it to. And it's very helpful to us in policy making terms to be able to learn from those experiences too.
Thank you.
Would you like me to answer on openness and transparency now?
Please.
I believe that openness and transparency is a fundamental building block of improvement. You don't get improvement if you don't have openness and transparency. And the issue, of course, is how that openness and transparency is then dealt with and treated. So if, for example, something happens, something very minor in relation to the care of a patient. First of all, it's essential that the patient is told. That's absolutely fundamental to this. But secondly, it's essential that that's recorded. Now, that might be something as minor as the wrong drug was brought. So not administered, but simply brought. Now, that is recorded as what would be called an incident of harm. Now, there wasn't actually harm to the patient. There was potential harm, but no actual harm, but it's still recorded. The issue then, in terms of how that plays out, is partly how it plays out within the space in which it happens, a ward or a theatre or whatever, and partly how it plays out in public. Because I'm encouraging people to make sure that people are able to report any incident at all, and to record it. But of course, if the public discourse then is incidents of harm have rocketed, you can understand why that is a sort of external inhibition to being to people being transparent, when in fact what we're trying to do is make sure that not that harm has rocketed, but that we're recording what has actually happened. And internally, if that recording is met defensively, then people will be less inclined to do it. If it's met openly with a view to learning from these incidents as part of people's professional and personal development, then they'll be encouraged to do it again. There is, of course, the issue of the duty of candour. People are required to report things. So I'm absolutely clear that although it may mean that it looks as though incidents are increasing when they're not, proper reporting, openness, transparency and recording are absolutely essential. I have no doubt about that at all. And if you had a senior clinician here, I am certain they would say the same.
So can I follow on? Do you have national guidelines for that? I'm thinking, you know, along the lines of, for example, say a significant adverse event.
Yeah.
There seems to be a huge disparity in you know, from one NHS board to another. I'm wondering whether are there national guidelines on how you classify these incidents, and is there pressure on boards to push these numbers down?
Well, all I can say, Mr. Whittle, is there isn't pressure from me. I wouldn't be pressing people to call something. If it's a significant adverse event, that is what it is. And I wouldn't be pressing them to call it anything else. The only way we will learn is by treating things with the appropriate level of seriousness. I'd be very happy to share with the committee the guidance we have around these matters. It would be too voluminous to go into in detail now, and some of it would require, I think, the advice of a clinician rather than me as a professional administrator. But it would be of no difficulty to share with the committee the guidance on all these issues, if you would find it helpful.
Okay. In its written submission, Unison Scotland suggested that awareness of helpline may be low because some concerns might be normalised, low-level or regular occurrences, and some staff may not feel that their concerns warrant a full-scale referral. I wonder what your views are on these observations, and how do you think this reflects on the current mechanism?
I'll bring Ms. Rodgers in a second. I think, first of all, there's no, to be simple about it, there's no such thing in my world as low-level bullying. It should not happen ever at all anywhere. So if there is a sense that something like that is being normalised, then that is utterly, fundamentally wrong. If there is a culture in a place where certain things are tolerated, my view is very clearly what you permit, you promote. So If I as a leader and manager am permitting something to happen, in effect I'm promoting it. Again, I would regard that as wrong. Now, we greatly value the partnership relationships and arrangements we have with trade unions such as Unison, and we do work with them to ensure that awareness is raised, that where people do have what might seem to be low-level concerns, there is still scope to raise them, because there is very clear evidence that where the workforce is engaged and feeling valued, they will deliver better. There is an absolute line of sight between an engaged workforce that feels valued and the care that we provide to people. But Ms. Rodgers could say more.
Thank you. Our intent is that the right thing happens the first time. And the quicker a resolution of a matter happens, the better. So if it is the case that what Unison are alluding to is something of a relatively modest nature is raised and resolved and therefore not reported, then I think there's an issue about reporting. But actually what we want to have happen is that the right thing happens the first time. So there are instances, and we've had conversations with the RCN and Unison and Unite and others, where they have been able to give examples of individuals who've raised concerns and had those concerns immediately addressed by their line manager, and that's happened and been resolved and we move on. And I think it's important that we are aware of those things, because again, coming back to the point that the DG was making, we need to be aware of issues when they're arising and be able to fix them. But actually, we want boards to be responsive at every level of leadership within the organisation. So if somebody's raising something that says, I need X, and they get X, then that's helpful. What I think we need to reinforce at every opportunity is the standards that are expected to apply, both in terms of our relationship with the boards and the boards' relationships with their employees. The standards of conduct, behaviour and all the rest of it, which are expected, and those are reciprocal things. They're not what we expect of employees, it's also about what employees can expect of the organisation that employs them. So we do want to hear about every instance where, I couldn't agree more with the DG, I don't think there is low-level bullying. I think you're either bullied or you're not. You can't be a bit pregnant. If something bad is happening to you in that space, then we need to be able to respond to that quickly. And the way that boards can respond to that quickly is by matters being safely and appropriately brought to people's attention and resolved.
Okay, thanks, Convener. If I could go back to the issue of confidence. When we took evidence from the City of Edinburgh Council, they provided a positive impression of their own independent external hotline facility, and suggested that anecdotal evidence and feedback demonstrated good confidence and trust in that particular system. To the extent that prior to the introduction of the council hotline, they'd received 3 public interest disclosures over an 8-year period, and by comparison, since the hotline was established in 2014, it received 53 calls, 11 of which resulted in major investigations. So that clearly indicates a sense of confidence in the in that particular independent external hotline. I'd be interested to hear your views on that.
Thanks. I'll ask Ms. Rodgers to come in a second. Just a couple of things to say. So, for example, there are a number of reports by Healthcare Improvement Scotland which have been published as a result of issues raised through these opportunities that people have. So I think there is evidence that not only that these issues are listened to, but they're taken seriously. And secondly, of course, we have different arrangements for reporting fraud, for example, so that wouldn't come through this helpline. I'm not saying someone who was concerned about it couldn't contact the helpline, of course they could, but there are other arrangements for reporting fraud. So it may be that some of the issues that were seen in Edinburgh were slightly differently dealt with, but Ms. Rodgers can come up with more detail on this.
Yeah, I think that point is very valid. I think the whistleblowing helpline, and we're learning about that as we go, and as I've already made comment previously, then we will review the effectiveness as we go forward in the next contracting round around a whistleblowing helpline. But it is one of a range of remedies. So the NHS has a number of policies and procedures, PIN guidelines, internal grievance procedures, NHS counter-fraud services, as the DG has alluded to. To date, Health Improvement Scotland have looked at 9 specific cases of the potential concern for them as arising from PCOR, from that line. They've been able to put some fairly substantial weight behind some of those investigations to make sure that there is an appropriate conclusion and the remedy of concerns where they have been raised. But it isn't finished yet. It's one of a range of remedies that we're developing as we go. We believe that there is some considerable merit in pursuing the independent national officer role. We are intending to pursue that. Previous question was, how confident are we that we will do that? It's our intention that we will have a proposition for parliamentary consideration in reasonable order of time. We're hoping to be in a position to consult by the autumn. And we understand the additional assurance that might be given by that independent national officer role.
Thank you.
Anna McKay.
Thank you. Yes, I wanted to ask you if you are aware of concerns about a sort of culture of fear within the NHS, fear of whistleblowing in case that person would be penalised. I wanted to ask your thoughts on that and if you'd considered any other sort of mode of ways of people bringing forward a complaint other than, you know, whistleblowing.
So I'll start and then Shirley Rodgers will follow on. It was one of the reasons that decided to, that it was appropriate to speak to the press about this. There was an article in the Herald and reported elsewhere in September of last year. Because I believe that as Chief Executive of the National Health Service in Scotland, I need to set the tone for our behaviour. And I wanted to make it clear that from my perspective, there is no place in which people should be inhibited through fear from raising concerns. Clearly, I did that because I recognised that in some places there was some fear. I wouldn't have done it if I had thought there was nothing to fix. So I'm accepting that that can happen. Sometimes the fear is well founded. In other words, people have had bad experiences in the past and that has caused them to think that they might have a bad experience again. Sometimes it's not very well founded in that it's just a vague fear that if I do something or say something, something bad might happen. In either case, I want to continue to work with people through the partnership arrangements we have to ensure that people can, without fear, raise concerns. That's why, in response to Mr. Whittle's question, I'm pressing so hard on this issue of transparency. Even at a very basic level, if there is a way to do something, that's clear and understood, that's a lot easier than having to work out what to do. Now, Ms. Rodgers will be able to speak eloquently about PIN guidelines and they're in place. But my point is that there needs to be something that is locally visible that says, you know, if I've got a concern, this is how I raise it. Because if you've already got a concern, then having to work out what to do next with it is in a sense an inhibition in itself. So I'm seeking to set that standard. I'm seeking to be clear that bullying and harassment in any form whatsoever has no place anywhere in the National Health Service. Have I got it completely fixed? No, I have not.
When you said that some of the fears were well-founded, what action do you take when you know that that has happened?
Well, let me give you an example. I mean, obviously, I can't talk about individual cases, but this example is sufficiently anonymous that I believe it could be usable. An MSP approached me on behalf of a constituent and put before me some documentation about that constituent's experience. I read that documentation and I gave it to Shirley Rodgers, Director of Workforce, and to Fiona McQueen, the Chief Nursing Officer. Between them, they engaged with the health board in question and with the nurse director in question. And as a result of that, the person's concerns were taken up and addressed appropriately. And what I'm saying to you very explicitly is, up to that point, they had not been. That person was not treated respectfully, their concerns were not heard properly, and there were many factors. There are always two sides to every story, but the basic bottom line was that person's concerns were not properly heard, and when they were, the situation was resolved satisfactorily.
A member of staff being disciplined, or
No, what that resulted in was that some issues that this member of staff had been experiencing in relation to their ability to perform their work effectively, these issues were stopped being treated as trivial and secondary, and were treated as issues which ought to be addressed and resolved. And there was also appropriate professional development and training put in place in that area so that staff generally could understand the appropriate way to deal with these issues and the appropriate way to listen to concerns as they were raised.
If I might just add to that, and in a number of ways, if I might, I have personally been involved in issues where remedial action has resulted in disciplinary action on a range from guidance to dismissal. But if I might just talk a bit more broadly about the culture of fear question. So I've been an NHS manager for well over 20 years. I think and all of that time in NHS Scotland. NHS Scotland is a big place. It's 156,000 people, 22 health boards across our geography. I think when we describe culture, it's very difficult for us to make a sweeping statement around any of that. So the culture in South Glasgow is not the same as the culture in North Glasgow, never mind the culture in Glasgow versus the culture in Orkney. So I think one of the things that we need to be is culturally intelligent and sensitive to the circumstances around. That said, we have been very clear about the standards that we expect to see in NHS Scotland. We have an internationally regarded workforce strategy. The first of only five elements of that strategy are around culture and values, how we behave to each other in a modern workplace that is supportive of people who have a right to expect to be treated in a particular way in the way that we work. We review all of our policies, our employment policies, in light of the Everyone Matters strategy and in light of those values and behaviours, and we do learn. We do learn from the experiences of individuals who come and talk to us about their experiences. Over the last year, we've been focusing particularly around leadership and management development activity. As committee members will be aware, leadership and management development has been an issue for the NHS in Scotland. We had a target to reduce managerial costs where we could, and at the same time as we've been doing that, we've been very successful in reducing managerial costs. We've also been working very hard about improving the level of managerial and leadership behaviours and the quality of that input. We've been doing a lot in that space. But we've also listened to other voices. So we've had trade union representatives, experts in this field, and a variety of others come and share with us their experiences of how they are managed within the NHS, and we've learnt from that. Indeed, I've shared the platform in a number of different forums with organisations and individuals, from Royal Colleges to organisations such as Stonewall and various others, about how we create the kind of environment or support the kind of environment which at its best I think is world class but is not at its best everywhere. So we've been doing a lot in that space. You'll have seen from evidence produced that we've also been investing around the board table in terms of understanding at a governance level about board's responsibilities in this regard, and we've introduced the concept of board champions. In some places that's landed extremely well, in other places there's still more work to do to make sure that people are confident about those roles. We have more to do in terms of telling the successful stories as well. So if we're serious about shifting culture, then we need to have some messages where we're able to demonstrate that people have raised concerns and those concerns have been appropriately and satisfactorily addressed. And we've got some examples of that. We're just not as complete yet in how we're able to talk about those things in a way that gives people confidence around it. I'm not going to talk to this committee. I'm sure you will be more than well aware of the... I don't feel the need to talk to you about what it takes to be a learning organisation. But all of the evidence about how you create and support and develop learning organisations is that you fundamentally change the relationship that you have with your staff in the area of blame.
Okay.
And that's really where our efforts are targeted. So when we're talking about the alert line, when we're talking about our champions, when we're talking about our PIN policies and procedures, when we're talking about the INO, we recognise that in order to shift that culture, it will take a number of initiatives working together to make sure that we've always got the response that our workforce deserve.
Okay, thank you. Cody?
Thank you, Chair. Mr. Gray and Ms. Rodgers, can I turn now to the new concept, the integrated joint boards, which, I, as Mr. Gray knows, I have a bit of experience about. How would you address the concerns expressed by Tim Hiddleston of Unison Scotland on this issue, in that integrated joint boards create issues for whistleblowers knowing who to approach, as local councils and health boards have vastly different terms of conditions and policies?
So if you... are an employee of the NHS, of NHS Scotland, then you can and should still use the policies that your employer has. Similarly, I can't obviously speak for local authorities, but similarly I would expect local authorities to do the same, local authority staff to do the same rather. So clearly, as integration proceeds, people are working very closely together, and an incident may become known to two people, one of whom works for one employer and one for another. And I accept that might be something that they would need to think about. But the route for any employee as an individual remains unchanged by their working within an integration partnership.
Can I build on that? Mr. Gray is entirely right when he talks about the fact that if you're an NHS Scotland employee, you continue to enjoy and be subject to NHS terms and conditions, and similarly if you come at it from a local authority perspective. But the reality is that for most people, their experiences of what happens when things go wrong are determined by the first response they get. So if they raise a concern, we need people to be more confident than simply saying, what terms and conditions are you subject to? So we're working very carefully with the chief officers to make sure that each, and you'll be aware of this with the background that you have, some of them have come from local authority backgrounds, some of them from the NHS and some elsewhere. We're working very carefully with chief officers to make sure that they all have an understanding of the terms and conditions that pertain, so that their first response to things can be something that's appropriate and supportive.
Can I ask supplementary to that, Chair? Can I? Obviously, I understand fully that the employees have this issue about between local authority contracts and NHS contracts. Do you feel that has some bearing on the current position and maybe confusion and lack of people coming forward?
I don't have evidence to suggest that, but I can't obviously say, it's very difficult to say that something is not so. What I can say is that early on in the establishment of the integration partnerships, I was asked at a, an annual review of an NHS board by the Partnership Forum if I wouldn't simply impose the partnership arrangements which apply in the NHS to the integration partnerships. And I said that I would not do so because, in fact, imposing arrangements on anybody is not a good way to get them to accept them or benefit from them. What we are finding, however, in a number of the partnerships is that the type, by that I mean the integration partnerships, the type of partnership arrangements that we have in the NHS are being, as it were, being drawn forward into the integrated joint boards. And I genuinely welcome that, because if people can have access to one set of partnership arrangements when they're at work, I think that's of benefit. But I remain of the view that imposing things on people who work for other employers is not the way to gain their confidence.
Can I just quickly drill down a bit? Is this lack of you imposing it, I'm not saying you should do, and I understand fully, Mr. Gray, where you're coming from, not leading to confusion and therefore denigrating the reporting system?
No, I think the opposite, because there isn't a circumstance in which any employee, regardless of whether from a local authority or a health board or indeed one of our third sector partners, there isn't a circumstance in which an employee can't raise a concern. So it's not that there's a, by not having the NHS partnership arrangements in place, they can't raise a concern. And I think I would be more likely to damage the prospects of people having confidence in the arrangements if I were to impose them than if we did it by proper negotiation. But Ms. Rodgers may want to add.
A couple of issues about how we've been seeking to influence in that space, because you will understand, and committee members will understand, that it's not just a matter of the employees being the local authority and the NHS, but there's also third sector, independent sector, and all sorts of other people who get involved in that space. So two things that I think might be of use for the committee to have an understanding of. The first is the NHS methodology for looking at employees' experience at work is something called iMatter. iMatter was something that was developed in concert with an academic institution, in that instance the University of Dundee, and it's essentially a piece of self-diagnostic and team diagnostic work about how people are experiencing their life at work. It's held in high regard. It's been rolled out to good effect across the NHS in Scotland. We've been able to share that with partners across the IJB landscape, and we've now got a large number of IJBs who are undertaking the same methodology, and indeed four local authorities in Scotland who are in discussion with us about how they might use that across the whole of their local authority workforce. That's been quite a useful tool. The other thing which might be helpful for committee to appreciate is that from before we enacted the IJB landscape, we started a process called the HR Working Group, which is essentially looking at the HR implications of an integrated service delivery using employees from different organisations. The HR Working Group, which is something that I previously chaired, is something which has been looking at these particular issues and seeking to share experience and share methodologies, because I think we'd also be the first to acknowledge that the NHS is not necessarily the best at everything. So we've shared methodologies around job evaluation, we've shared methodologies about workforce planning, and indeed we've looked at things like staff surveys, taking the temperature, whistleblowing and various other bits and pieces.
Yeah, that's fine. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much for that. Unless there are any final questions, can I thank you very much for your evidence today. I think that we found that very useful. We have to now decide what action we want to take on this petition. There has been a suggestion that we refer it to the Health and Sports Committee on the basis that they are having an inquiry on NHS governance, creating a culture of improvement, and it would seem that this conversation, this discussion around whistleblowing would comfortably fit into that. Would that be agreed? Yeah. Okay, so we'd be referring it to the Health and Sports Committee under Rule 15.6.2, which would mean it wouldn't come back to the committee. But I think we have probably come to the end of our consideration of it, but again, the evidence from this session and other sessions would be provided to Health and Care Committee. Is there anything else people would suggest? No? In that case, if that's agreed, can I thank you very much again for your attendance today. I think we'd really appreciate the time you've taken to meet with the committee and the way in which you've answered very fully the questions that we've raised with you. So can I thank you for your attendance, and can I suspend Ben briefly for a changeover of witnesses. We can call the meeting back to order again. We now move to agenda item 2 on new petitions, and we're taking evidence today on petition 1631 by Maureen McVey on child welfare hearings. So this first new petition we'll consider today is petition 161 by Maureen McVey on child welfare hearings. We're joined this morning by Maureen and June Loudon, Secretary of Grandparents Apart, as well as Scott McVey. Can I welcome you to this meeting? And can I invite Maureen to make an opening statement of not more than 5 minutes, and after that we'll get the opportunity to ask some questions.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank the Public Permissions Committee for giving me the opportunity to discuss my petition. I'm calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to change the laws that govern the recording of discussions at child welfare hearings so that presiding sheriffs have access to such records. My petition is also under the auspices of Grandparents Apart, of which I am a member, who at their heart want what is best for our children involved in family disputes. Whilst the child welfare system has its merits, the recording of same would benefit all users. I don't mean to say anything in this regard, but I don't know if everybody knows that a child welfare hearing is different from a children's hearing, and our comments are on the child welfare hearing. We have seen within Grandparents of families affected by how the child hearing welfare hearing system works and how others have been affected by the experience of the same. We see how it could be improved for children and reduce the time for costs for the benefit of all concerned. And it's important to note that only 2% of contact cases go to a court system. It is evident that changes are progressing with the Scottish justice system, and that is positive, as is, changes take time. Grandparents Apart and its members welcome change. My petition for minute recording within the child welfare hearing should be a part of this change. Presently, there's no method of documenting what has been discussed at a child welfare hearing. Here are a few examples of where court costs, court time and children would benefit from recording of child welfare hearings. In many cases, what has been discussed during a previous child welfare hearing becomes an issue for the sheriff, and he or she then has to again discuss the points with the relevant parent. If minuted, a recording, the information would be available. Also, without recording, there could be a pattern of false information presented or of obstructive behaviour which can continue unchecked. The sheriff may note that one parent has been obstructive and this behaviour encroaches in the court's time. It's suggested that by the sheriff there will be serious repercussions if this happens. Sadly, in our experience, this behaviour is allowed to continue when at a following hearing a different sheriff is unaware of what has taken place at the previous hearing. If minuted or recorded, the information would be available for the sheriff. A parent's legal team, as another example, tries to discredit the other parent on erroneous information provided by their client, and the presenting sheriff informs their legal representative they have a duty of care to their client. Next child welfare hearing, there's a new legal representative and a new sheriff, unaware of what has gone on before, and again, if there's a note of this, this would promote expediency and it would not take so long for the child welfare hearing to continue. A legal aided parent also who has been granted a motion fails to turn up court and the legal rep is late, then deviates from the motion. This would be highlighted in the minutes. A pattern of obstructive behaviour in the past should be shown by minutes of the recording as well. And as the UN Convention on Rights of the Child, Article 3 says, all this is done in the child's best interest to have the best system possible. A client moves from one sheriffdom to another and the only available information the sheriff has is recontact via the interlocutor, which is the only thing you get after a child welfare hearing. The new sheriff has to elicit why the person has moved court and what the circumstances are. The new legal rep taking up valuable time which can be used to discuss contact issues. Again, a pattern of obstructive behaviour should be shown by minutes of recordings. Each of these examples has a detrimental effect on court time, court costs, but most importantly, the child. As decisions are delayed, it increases legal costs for parents, which can have a ripple effect on children. Both legally aided and self-funding, some of our members have experienced such scenarios. So there, I just keep saying that minutes of recording, highlighting what has been discussed, are really an important way forward, I would think, to let people know what has gone before. I was informed by Mrs. Anne Hampson, maybe some of you know Anne, Policy Officer for Scottish Civil Justice Council in January 26, that the SCJC Family Law Committee are actively considering case management in Sheriff Courts, family cases, and will shortly consider the findings. And in speaking with David Ross just the other day there, who is the present secretary of the Family Law Committee, he informed me that they are moving forward with this. There are many departments within the justice system who are looking to move forward and bring innovative practices to our legal system in Scotland, and this all takes time. I do hope that all these departments will continue to enhance the court system to encompass best practice within all forms of law, and especially in the family law field, of which child welfare hearing is a part. I note that any change to civil court procedures require a policy decision by the Scottish Government and a subsequent change in legislation. As Lord Gill and the present Lord President, Lord Carloway's wishes for a fairer and effective justice system are taken forward. I do hope that the review will look at using digital innovations within the child welfare hearing system to better support children and families. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, and I appreciate that explanation. Is it my understanding of what you say, that a child welfare hearing can take place and there's basically no evidence of what was discussed in that, or what would be the evidence? What would the sheriff have? We just a note that the meeting took place.
Yes, it's just a piece of paper which they call the interlocutor, and it only discusses the decision made by the sheriff on contact. You know, this person gets so many days, you know, the one parent gets so many days, one parent another. There is, if someone asks, a note can be appended to the interlocutor if someone asks for it, but that's not normal practice. It's not always done. So the only thing that has been discussed at the child welfare hearings, whatever's been discussed, is not mentioned really in this piece of paper. It's just what the contact issues, the time, and all the rest of it.
So there's no the patterns of behaviour or
no,
perhaps could be
all
perceived as blocking things.
No,
it wouldn't exist at all.
No.
Do you know if there are other types of hearings, such as tribunal hearings, which are routinely minuted or recorded? Is it unusual that the child welfare hearing is different from other tribunals, or is this the norm?
I think it's different. It's heard in a closed court, and it's only the parents and their legal representatives and the sheriff that are present. There's nobody else there, that's all that's there. The children's hearings are slightly different. They're held somewhere mm-hmm. else before, and there's a table with yeah. everyone there. Yeah. And I would assume that they are minuted, but I'm not certain. Mm-hmm. But I'm not aware of anywhere else that doesn't minute things. Or
and it's in a closed court because it's dealing with a child?
Correct. I think that's my understanding, yes.
Okay. Rona Mackay?
Thank you. Good morning.
Morning.
Yes, just on your last point there, I mean, I have to admit, I'm a former children's panel member. So the children's reporter sits and takes a note of everything that's happening. And after each hearing, all our notes are written up thoroughly. So there's mm-hmm. always a record kept. Uh-huh. So I'm really surprised to hear what you're saying today. I have to say that. Mm-hmm. So how would you envisage it being recorded? What method, you know, would you think? Video, audio, what would you...
Well, it really is, I mean, I would think just recorded, you know, mm-hmm. just IT, you know, just recording it.
Uh-huh. An audio digital recording?
Yes, an audio uh-huh. digital recording. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether it would be more beneficial to have it videoed, mm-hmm. but I know that there was a case by... that Lord Gill had mentioned, and there was a dispute. It was slightly different in Melbourne, and it was they did a video linking type thing to Melbourne. It was about an mm-hmm. adoption case. Mm-hmm. So he suggests if you can do it in Melbourne, mm-hmm. you surely can do that in Scotland, yeah. you know, mm-hmm. record mm-hmm. and, you know, have that type of thing. But that was a video yeah. type link.
Mm-hmm. In your sort of experience and dealings with court staff, have you ever heard any of them mention anything around that it would be good to have a record, or, you know, has anyone commented to you, or is it just accepted practice that it doesn't happen?
I think it's just accepted practice. I know that our members that we have in Grandparents Apart mention it, but however, uh-huh. I've uh-huh. never heard them doing the legal uh-huh. profession or okay. you know, in court mention yeah. it at yeah. all. No.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Back to the point you made earlier about somebody can make a request for a note to be attached to an interlocutor. Who would that be?
Well, I think June could speak in this because you had experience of that, didn't you, with one of the members?
It's really if they have a particular concern, they can ask for it to be noted. But if they don't ask for it to be noted, if they don't know who to ask for it to be noted, then it's not, and it just bypasses... Yeah. whoever is new to the next child hearing, and they constantly go over the same information again, wasting time for the point of the meeting.
Okay.
So it's a cost thing, a time thing, and it delays any decisions that are made about the child.
Okay, thanks very much. Brian Whittle?
Good morning. Why do you think child welfare hearings are not currently minuted or recorded?
I think it's probably the confidentiality thing. I'm not sure. The answer is I'm not sure. But I would think it would probably be the confidentiality thing. And the sheriff does, sometimes the sheriffs don't, it depends, take the views of both parents. But I don't know why. I think it is mainly maybe a confidentiality thing. But I think nowadays in this modern age we can, you know, either... You know, you just don't use the name in recording, or read it. If it's, you know, recorded in minutes and paper, you redact it. So I don't see why, you know, that should put a stop to it, just the confidentiality thing and the data protection type thing.
Can I ask a supplement to that? Are you calling for it to be publicly available or just available within the judicial system?
Oh, the minutes of the
minutes
meeting?
Minutes of the meeting, yeah.
No, probably just within the court system, although I don't know. Just in the
just
court
so
system.
So
that the sheriff is aware of, I mean, in some cases, some of our, you know, people in Grandparents Apart have had five and six different sheriffs each mm-hmm. time they go to the sheriff court. So the one sheriff that has been taking the case doesn't know what's happened before, apart from the interlocutor. Mm-hmm. Or maybe they do write some notes, but I'm not party to that. But as far as I'm aware, it's just the interlocutor. And I know that in a case where a family moved sheriffdom, the sheriff had no explanation, you know, previously of what had happened, or nothing in front of him to say, well, this, you know. So that, I think, is really would be helpful to sheriffs. helpful all round to be open and transparent.
Thank you.
Angus Macdonald.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning.
Good morning.
Your petition notes that the Sheriff Court Ordinary Cause Rules address issues of confidentiality. And I was just wondering if you could explain a bit more about what confidentiality issues may arise as a result of the action that you're seeking.
I think the confidentiality is if a child, as they go older, maybe you don't know what's going to happen in the future with these contact cases that go in for so long, and I wonder if the reason is for this that in the future the child maybe wants to discover what happened when they were younger and requests, you know, notes of the case, then obviously they could see what happened. So I'm not 100% certain in that one, but I think that was the basis of that.
Okay, and after you'd raised that, the SCJC suggested that you should seek an update from the Scottish Government. Did you do that?
I did that by speaking to David Ross.
Okay.
I spoke to him and he said, because I couldn't see it in their minutes on their webpage, mm-hmm. I couldn't see it, so I contacted who I thought was the secretary at and was informed it was now David, and he said to me they were discussing the child welfare. It's only at second phase just now, and he said he would send me a copy, but that was only yesterday, so I haven't received it as yet.
Okay,
thanks.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning. With
reference to your comments on confidentiality, which we're discussing just the last few minutes, could you explain a bit more about who you think should be able to access the meeting records?
I think really just the sheriff that's mm-hmm. in front of the case, really just to access the records, really because, or you mean access the records to provide them with information prior? Yeah, I just think it should be the sheriff, that's all I was thinking, just so he's aware of things that are happening. But it could be that maybe the lawyers...
Continuation, things like that. Yeah,
But I don't think it should be common knowledge
right.
as such, you know, because I would think that that's not...
So the confidentiality at that level, yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
I think so.
Do you agree with that?
Yeah. It's just to really enhance the process, speed it up and make it easier for everybody concerned with that.
Yeah.
So it would reduce the repetition and lack of awareness.
Yeah. Mr. McVey, what do you think?
Yeah, it's purely for continuity to assist the sheriffs in making an appropriate decision. It's also to stop the kind of groundhog day that happens when you go to child welfare hearings, that you go over the same accusations and stuff that are put against you, where it's already been dealt with by a previous sheriff, and it just delays the process. And it's costly for the courts, and also mm-hmm. it doesn't help the children get the correct decision to be made.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay. I'm wondering, is the issue then that there's not a proper picture of what's already been an argument before, so that the sheriff comes to it and perhaps the same story is told, which has already been rebutted earlier on? So it's both unnecessarily delaying things in terms mm-hmm. of get an outcome for the young person, but also perhaps there's no record, the frustration of maybe somebody's argued the same line before, which has been proven to be a nonsense, but mm-hmm. you have to start again.
It's almost like it can be used as an intentional delaying tactic to get to reach a decision.
Okay. And is there, this is not maybe directly related to this, but there is a question about in contact cases where if contact has not been maintained over a period of time and that therefore is broken, if there is a delay, mm-hmm. then it becomes an issue. Is it in the interest of the child to try and re-establish a relationship? Is that sometimes why that delay is used?
That's right, yeah. Because the longer the delay, the delay goes on, the harder it makes it for parent and child to re-establish a relationship. So obviously, if one party or another wants to prevent that contact, it can be used through this system to do that and to prevent the contact, delay the contact mm-hmm. and make it harder for the parents to have a relationship, maintain a relationship or re-establish that relationship.
So the fact that there isn't a record of the meeting actually creates an incentive to delay, because you can then keep repeating the same issue.
Absolutely.
With the consequence that it's not the end of contact, which is then much more difficult. Mm-hmm. So it's more than just simply the information, it's actually
Absolutely.
Perhaps an active strategy for some.
Yes.
That your suggestion is that this would deal with that?
Hopefully, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It would make it easier for courts as well and reduce costs greatly.
Has there been any conversation with sheriffs about this? Sheriffs, you know, about whether they have a view on this?
No, but I contacted quite a few of the agencies to find out what the process was. But you know, I haven't spoken personally to a sheriff, but Law Society and various people that I've spoken to.
Okay. Uh-huh. Can I just finally ask? I know that or understand you're connected with Grandparents Apart UK. And that organisation attended the Scottish Government Stakeholder Summit on the forthcoming Family Justice Modernisation Strategy last October. Do you know whether your concerns about child welfare hearings were raised at that meeting?
Yes, they were. Joan can speak to it, weren't they? They're not raised. Mm. What was the meeting that you were at and they were raised?
I don't think they were raised specifically. It was brought up.
What was the meeting?
It was brought up as a way of... It was connected with the... non-compliance with court orders, and just the recording of things was brought up as a potential for assisting with that
mm-hmm.
sort of avenue as well.
Okay.
Just by creating the picture for ongoing court appearances and such like. It's just part of the bigger picture of the improvements that really need to be made to speed up the process for the benefit of the courts and the benefit of the family.
Okay.
I think there was a meeting in which yourself was present and other organisations, and it's actually online.
Okay.
And it did comment on the child welfare.
Okay.
I haven't got that to hand at the moment, sorry.
No, well, we can have a look at that as well. Mm-hmm. Are there any further questions? No? Mm-hmm. Okay, can I thank you very much for that evidence? I think people would agree there is an issue here. It would be interesting to know why they're not recorded.
Yeah.
Is this unusual?
Uh-huh.
What the view of the people who are managing the process, the sheriffs and others,
yes.
Are on this? Is there, is there something about if you record it, you then have to test it for proof? I don't know.
No.
But these are, I think there is an argument. If people are using the fact that there's not, these questions are not being recorded as a means of further delay, and we create an incentive in the system for that,
uh-huh.
I think we would be anxious about that. Good suggestions of what we might do?
Certain logic to what's been said here, obviously, and I think we're quite interested to maybe understand from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service and some sort of Scottish Children's Report Administrations and others what their views are on this as to a reason why they're not recorded.
Yeah,
that seems logical to me.
Yeah, I think you should, ask the Scottish
Government if, and also if it's going to be included in the Family Justice Modernisation Strategy. But I think it's also important to write to the various court system, courts and tribunal service, the Children's Reporter and the Scottish Child Law Centre, Sheriff's Association, all these bodies that would be connected with this to find out their view on what's been said and try and elicit some information.
There's a compelling case, but there may be an equally there is a
we
case
just,
that we haven't
don't
heard
know.
At what the
yeah.
other side of that would
yeah.
be.
Yeah.
The Children and Young People's Commissioner of Scotland might be another
yes.
person
yes,
to
definitely.
Go to.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I think there's quite a wee bit
a lot
of work
of avenues.
We can do there.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, the children's organisations and others that may have an interest too. And that will certainly give us some information that can reflect
yes.
further on the case that you've been made.
Mm-hmm.
If there is nothing else, can I thank you very much for your attendance? We really appreciate you taking
thank
time
you
to give us evidence in your petition. And can I suspend briefly to allow witnesses to leave the table before we consider next petition?
Thank you.
Bring the meeting back to order. We're now going to deal with petition 1632 by Amanda Macdonald and concession of transport for carers. So the second new petition we're considering today is petition 1632 by Amanda Macdonald on concession of transport for carers. Members have a note by the clerk and a spice briefing. The petition is calling for free concession of transport for carers. The petitioner highlights the financial difficulties faced by many carers, the limits placed on social life and the impact this has on mental health. Members will see from the spice briefing that there are an estimated 759,000 adult carers aged 16 and over in Scotland and 29,000 carers under the age of 16. The spice briefing also explains that the existing concession travel scheme in Scotland is available to people aged 60 and over and to disabled people. There is, of course, provision in Scotland for so-called companion cards, which can be used by eligible companions when they are assisting a person who is eligible for concessionary travel. The companion cards can be used for journeys that commence and terminate at the same locations as the eligible persons being assisted. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions for action to take on this petition.
I think, Chair, if I could, I attended a sort of young carers event last year, of which the opportunity and a sort of a round table discussion. And one of the things that was highlighted was that, you know, they have to pay out of their own pocket, for example, if they have to go down and collect a prescription, if they have to go on the bus and collect a prescription, or if they for the carer, for the person that's being cared for. And it seems to me that in those circumstances, having free transport, it would be a logical step to have. Now, I understand it would be really difficult to apply that across the whole of the care system, but in those circumstances, it seems logical to me and not costly to allow them free transport.
Would there be an issue about identification of who those carers would be? I mean, there are some carers we know who have to give up work in order to look after the person they're caring for, so they're actually in a position, their own financial and emotional well-being is affected by being a carer. But and we know that some young people are, you know, taking on a caring role, but is there an issue about identification?
I think there is an issue of identification, but I don't think that negates the real life issues around those who have this problem. And I think, you know, the issue of identification shouldn't prevent us from looking at this, especially in our young carers. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're sitting on a welfare payment, to be able to have to pay out, you know, a few pounds here and there every time you have to go down and pick up a prescription or you know, go with the person you're cared for, it shouldn't impact on that, I don't think.
Okay, any other views, Rona?
Just I noticed that in 2015 the Transport Minister at the time, Derek Mackay, you know, stated the fact that there are over 153,000 cardholders aged 16 to 18 and young full-time volunteers up to the age of 25 who are entitled to concessionary bus and rail travel throughout Scotland. So, you know, that's quite an important... I'm not saying it means we shouldn't inquire again to see for an update on the situation on young carers generally, or carers generally, but that's, you know, quite a robust response from him 2 years ago.
Okay. Angus
McDonald? Yeah, thanks. I mean, I think it's worth bearing in mind that the Scottish Government has made a commitment to increase the award of carers allowance to the same rate as job seekers allowance. But that said, you know, if that extra money was just to go on bus fares, then it wouldn't be long before it was used up. So clearly there's a strong argument here which we should put to the Government to see their view. Mm-hmm.
I come in. I think yes, I agree with what Angus is saying there, but I think we're looking at impact on local authorities and therefore where this is coming from, because, you know, bus passes are paid, come out of the local authority budget, and therefore there's an impact. So I think we're going to have to include COSLA in this discussion, and I know it's on the recommendations, and I certainly support that, because there are things, again, we were talking about rurality and different places where different distances and things like that. I think this is very much a more local issue as mm-hmm. well. Mm-hmm. So we need to include them.
Yeah. So I think if we want to contact the Scottish Government, mm-hmm. COSLA, mm-hmm. I'm also issued, I know we know from our notes that Enable has been highlighting the issue around concessionary travel for people with learning disabilities and where that actually lies. You know, what are the distinctions between it? It depends on what level of disability allowance you're entitled to. So there's quite a lot of complexities here. So I suppose we're interested in initial cuts and what these organisations think about this. Would this be a priority? I think it would also be worth meeting in form with the petitioner to discuss actually what was the motive behind the petition and maybe to get a better understanding from their point of view of what they believe that this petition would address. What is the need that has been addressed? And I think Brian has identified some of that. Mm-hmm. And we should, I think, probably be writing to the carers organisation, I mean, Carers UK, but there are also Scottish-based organisations that might have a view. The Carers Coalition and so on might have a view too. Angus?
If we are writing to the Scottish Government, I'm just wondering if it may be hopefully not presumptuous to ask them to give a costing, given that the numbers estimated are 759,000 adult carers over 16 and 29,000 under 16, if they could have a rough costing of the impact, that would be helpful.
Okay. I think what we're seeing is this is an interesting petition. We want to explore further both the motives for it, what's it intended to address, and whether it's, you know, being addressed in other ways in other places.
We're getting down into the realms of IJBs as well, because this is going to impact on that. So I think there is a real, even the NHS involved, so there's a compendium of organisations before we can come to a decision on this. Mm.
And some of it is around transport and access to transport as well. So yeah, it's like this opens up a whole number of issues that we've obviously been flagging up in other places. So if we're agreeing, we write to the Scottish Government, to COSLA, to the carers organisation, and we will agree to meet with the petitioner to give an opportunity to get their perspective. Is that agreed? Okay, if we can then move on to agenda item 3 and continued petitions. Fittingly, on World Book Day, petition 1581 by Duncan Wright on behalf of Save Scotland School Libraries on saving Scotland school libraries. So this petition was lodged by Duncan Wright on behalf of Save Scotland Schools Libraries. Since our last consideration of this petition, we have received submissions from COSLA and the petitioners. From those responses, it appears as though there is contrasting evidence about the accessibility and availability of e-reading materials. COSLA says that an increased use of technology allows children to access a wide range of reading materials, while the petitioners claim that their evidence suggests that the take-up is low. They claim this can be due to costs, licensing restrictions and Wi-Fi availability in schools. The COSLA submission broadly acknowledges the benefits of the action called for in the petition, but considers that these should be weighed against other factors, including the benefits from other areas of educational provision, the potential strain placed in other areas of local authority services, and, quote, the erosion of local democracy by undermining the role of local elected councillors in making budget decisions. The petitioners suggest that having a national strategy will ensure the positive impact a professionally staffed school library can have on attainment and curriculum delivery. They add that there is perhaps a lack of knowledge about what a modern school library, and librarian can offer. And I wonder if members have any views on what action we can take on this petition.
Chat with the cab secretary, I think.
I think, Convener, given the cabinet secretary has already agreed to appear in front of this committee to give evidence on another petition, it would be opportune to ask him to give evidence on this one as well.
Being elected member of council, where we have these decisions to make, I have to declare an interest, but I think it has to go to that level. From my experience, this is an issue for all local authorities, and so I think we need to generate it to a higher level to the cabinet secretary.
I was going to suggest, you know, writing to the cabinet secretary for his view rather than invite him here, but as you pointed out, if he's coming to committee anyway, maybe we could do it at the same time.
Yeah, it is not till later in April, isn't it? So maybe writing would be...
We can write and flag up the issues to him. I think, I suppose, what it seems to be what the petitioner is suggesting is local authorities making decisions in the context of constraints to the budgets. Do they properly understand the importance of a librarian and a professional librarian in a school when, you know, people can access information in loads of other ways? Now, many years ago, while I was still a school teacher, then a school librarian was really important. I suspect a library won't look or sound the same now as it did then, given that in the past you would go to the library to get information, which you can now get off your phone. But at the same time, are local authorities understanding properly? I think the case has been made by the petitioner that there is an added value that they're maybe not appreciating, and that's really what we might want to explore further, both with the Cabinet Secretary and what advice and guidance has been given to local authorities. It feels a bit like the petitioner suggesting that in times of constraint, the library is a luxury, whereas I think for librarians and those who really understand the system, they say actually it actively encourages in terms of closing the attainment gaps. I think these are the questions we want to explore.
I mean, there is a wider issue of libraries closing because not enough people are using them. I'm not saying that they should in any way, but that seems to be happening out with schools. So I think asking the Cabinet Secretary for his view would be the way to go initially.
Okay. Right. And we have got a session with the Cabinet Secretary for Education on a whole number of issues, so I think it would be a kind of a multi-purpose attendance would be probably quite useful. Libraries are wonderful, wonderful places. Okay, so I think we're agreed that we recognise issues are important. What is the information advice local authorities have in a sense of the importance of libraries, and an opportunity for us to explore that with the Cabinet Secretary. Okay, if we can then move on. The next petition is petition 1600 by John Chapman on speed awareness courses. In December, we agreed to write to the Department for Transport for an update on its timescale for publishing its report on its three-year evaluation of speed awareness courses on the basis of deferring consideration of this petition until that report was published. We also agreed to write to the Scottish Government. The Department of Transport has indicated that its final report won't be presented to the Project Board until the middle of this year. An announcement and publication will be made after that. It's difficult to interpret precisely how long that may be, but it could be up to 9 months from now before any findings are published. The petitioner feels that the Department for Transport are, quote, dragging their feet in this issue. The submission from Transport Scotland is a little more encouraging. It confirms that in September 2016, the Speed Awareness Course Steering Group advised the Strategic Partnership Board that the introduction of speed awareness courses in Scotland would be worthy of a trial. It notes that Police Scotland was to develop a full options proposal, which will be discussed at the Strategic Partnership Board meeting on 22nd March. It was also noted that any pilot of such courses in Scotland should be supported by ongoing evaluation and assessment as data becomes available. Can I invite members' views on actions to take on the petition? Don't know if anybody has any comments.
So we've heard, you know, till the petition is reported back later this year.
So we're waiting for the Department for Transport.
I think we have to, yeah.
But is there something we could do in relation to the Scottish Government in the meantime?
Yeah.
We can ask for an update from the Strategic Partnership Board to establish action that might be taken. Or in the absence of progress, I think, is probably where the petition is coming from here. And maybe push the Department of Transport on that one.
Okay. So we can write the Scottish Government to ask them for an update following the Strategic Partnership Board meeting in March, and ask what action it's going to take to establish a trial. And perhaps we can ask the Department for Transport to keep us advised when they're actually going to move on this question. Although I think, I don't know what the difficulty is. I don't know what the problem is, either from the Department of Transport or from the Scottish Government. It does feel to me to be eminently sensible that if we can do stuff to address the question of speed awareness, then we should be doing so. I think there's been adverts on the television recently.
It's
just highlight
public awareness. Is
I think there's a public awareness campaign just now, but I'm not sure who it's by. Mm-hmm. And that's obviously encouraging, but it just doesn't feel to me as if this would involve anything horribly complex or complicated to say we should do something in this. So I think we can maybe raise that with the Scottish Government, say that we do think it's something that is important, and we would like to have some sense of direction around it, if not urgency.
Yeah.
Is that
agreed? Yes, agreed, yeah.
Okay, so I think we can agree to write to the Scottish Government and perhaps just to ask the Department of Transport to keep us informed. But I think we do agree with the petitioner that this is something that could be moved at a bit more of a pace. Okay, if we can then move to petition 1603 by Mary Campbell-Jack and Douglas Beattie on behalf of Quakers in Scotland and Forces Watch on ensuring greater scrutiny, guidance and consultation on armed forces visits to schools in Scotland. This petition calls for greater scrutiny on armed forces visits to schools in Scotland. We've received a number of submissions since we last considered this petition, most of which express support for the action called for in the petition. The submissions we have received come from a range of organisations representing areas including children's rights, faith communities in Scotland, the scientific community and parents of school-aged children. We've also received a response from the Ministry of Defence, which provides some information about activities in schools and makes the offer of a briefing for the committee. Skills Development Scotland has also provided a submission outlining how they work with the armed forces. What are members' views and what action we may wish to take on this petition?
Well, I'm on record as supporting this petition, and you know, I'd be interested in hearing from the Cabinet Secretary for Education or a minister, and from COSLA, because it's obviously relates to schools and local authority control over schools. The submissions, I mean, there's a large amount of submissions who agree with the petitioner. The EIS, the National Union of Students, the Scottish Parent Teachers Council. So I think it's definitely one we should take forward to get more information from decision makers, and to take it forward. It's a big issue, and I think it has to be looked into thoroughly.
Okay. Can I suggest, Chair, that we accept the offer of a briefing from the Ministry of Defence? And also maybe ask for the senior officers from each of the services to come forward if we feel the briefing's not detailed enough or come up to the standard we want. And okay. That's as a fallback.
Okay. Is that agreed? So we would want to hear from the Cabinet Secretary and from COSLA. We would want to accept the offer of a briefing from the Ministry of Defence, and that I think at this initial stage we are recognising the very strong views that have been expressed by people who have responded to this, but also that, you know, I think that perhaps there's some folk who think is it appropriate for the armed forces to come in at all, but actually the petitioner is just simply saying there should be guidance and it should be transparent, and I think this is the question that we want to explore. But I think we would want to acknowledge and thank all of those who have responded to the petition and given us further information. Okay. If that's agreed, we can move on to petition 1604 by Catherine Matheson on inquest for all deaths by suicide in Scotland. The next continued petition on the agenda is petition 1604 by Catherine Matheson on inquest for all deaths by suicide in Scotland. Members will see that we've received three submissions and a response from the petitioner. The Minister for Mental Health supports the petitioner's call to extend the scope of the review under Section 37 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2015 to include both patients who were released from hospital or receiving care in the community under compulsory treatment orders. The Minister has also explained the process that's been followed to introduce the duty of candour procedure in health and social care settings under the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine etc. and Care Scotland Act 2016. There appears to be a lack of support from stakeholders to expand the Section 37 review to include an inquest-type system. The views expressed consider that this may be duplicative and will not add value. The petitioner considers this is necessary because the existing systems are too slow and inadequately address the complexities of suicide. There is support from some stakeholders for the petitioner's suggestions to improve the suicide review process, such as the guidance on who should participate in a suicide review. The existing guidance says that the chair, quote, should be sufficiently removed from the event. In the petitioner's view, the guidance should explicitly require the person to be independent, such as from a different health board. And I wonder if members have comments or suggestions for action.
I think writing to the HIS, for sure, looking for information how many health authorities are meeting the targets to commence a suicide review within the 2 weeks and complete it within the 3 months. I think also it would be seeking information how many families or carers can raise their concerns. with HIS when they consider that the authorities are not learning from suicide reviews, particularly the ones that have been highlighted in findings by the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman.
Okay. I think we did find this a very compelling petition when it came before
very
us.
Very much,
And I hope that the petitioner feels that there is at least some progress and acknowledgement of the fact that they would extend the review to people who have committed suicide in the community when under under a compulsory treatment order. I think that is progress, and I would hope that the petitioner would be encouraged by that. Is there anything else that you think we should be doing? So we're going to write to the Health Improvement Scotland asking about the question of meeting targets and how bereaved families or carers can raise concerns. Is there anything else?
We may ask the Scottish Government to, you know, the time scale of the Section 37 review, and just to get some more information surrounding that.
We'll just ask them for an update.
An update, yeah.
Is that agreed?
Yes, okay. Agreed, yeah.
Okay, thanks very much for that. We're now moving on to petition 1619 by Stuart Knox on access to continuous glucose monitoring. The next petition is by Stuart Knox. We've received responses in this petition from the Scottish Government and the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation. As members know, we have also previously agreed to undertake fact-finding engagement activities on this petition, with arrangements for this being taken forward by the clerks. Do members wish to seek further information in relation to the petition at this point? I think we will get details of the engagement event soon, but that is something that I think that gives an opportunity to get a proper sense of what is driving this petition and more generally the issues around the care for people with diabetes.
The cross-party group for diabetes, and there's not an awful lot of information coming out from there around the accessibility for this, the glucose monitoring, and it's that old cliche of postcode lottery.
Mm-hmm.
It depends where you live and whether or not you get access to it. So I think that would definitely be something we need to explore further.
I think there is this clearly that from our notes, the Scottish Government has provided additional funding, but the question is, where is that funding going to go?
Yeah.
Will it go between provision of insulin pumps and this CGM technology, which, you know, certainly the evidence we're receiving is quite a compelling argument. This is really effective. So it would be, we'd be asking the Scottish Government about some of the details around that. The extra funding is clearly welcome, but how is it going to be distributed?
I mean, certainly there was compelling evidence from some sufferers from diabetes who have gone on to this kind of glucose monitoring and the impact that's had on their, you know, significant impact that's had on their lives. But I think also the fact that technology is moving forward so quickly that the worry is by the time we get to a conclusion, we're on something else.
Okay, so I think that if we agree then that we write in those terms and we will get details about the engagement event in due course. We can then move on to petition 1622 by Stephen Duff on making failure to recycle a criminal offence. Following our initial consideration of this petition, we've received submissions from the Scottish Government, COSLA and the petitioner. The Scottish Government is not considering making failure to recycle a criminal offence, and COSLA does not support the action called for in the petition. The Scottish Government and COSLA highlight work that is currently progressing through the Scottish Household Recycling Charter, which is a joint initiative designed to introduce a consistent approach to recycling across the country. Financial support to the Charter has been provided by Zero Waste Scotland, and the most recent information says that 23 local authorities have already signed up to the Charter. Progress in the Charter has been monitored by a steering group made up of relevant agencies, including industry representatives, and its effectiveness will be assessed by local government once it is more fully embedded. The petitioner appears to welcome the move to standardise recycling methods, saying that it's, quote, long overdue, but makes the point that proposed penalties are, quote, urgently needed to change attitudes and will reinforce the central message of recycling properly. I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions for action. Angus?
Yes, thanks, convener. First, I'm sure we all understand the petitioner, Stephen Duff's sentiments contained in the petition. I'm sure we We'd all like to see 100% recycling rates, you know, sooner rather than later. But I think the Scottish Government, COSLA, and the individual local authorities, not to mention the 5 million Scots out there, have to be given the chance to come on board with regard to the Scottish Household Recycling Charter before we go down the route of criminalising the failure to recycle. Zero Waste Scotland has indicated that support is available to local authorities, as you've already mentioned, Convener, with regard to educating the public. So I think we should perhaps close the petition to allow the Scottish Household Recycling Charter to bed in. And given that there's 9 local authorities that still haven't signed up to the charter, we'd certainly encourage them to do so. But I think it's maybe premature to go down the route that the petitioner is suggesting and allow people to come on board over the next few months and years.
Okay. Any other views?
Okay, but I agree with my colleague. I think it's a work in progress. I think it's premature to do that. It's just not practical. So I would agree with closing it at this stage.
Mm-hmm. And even the issue of practicality of prosecution here would be, I don't see how that could possibly work, mm-hmm. So I do agree with my colleague here.
Yeah. I mean, I think we are acknowledging what the petitioner is wrestling with, which is the importance of recycling and the consequences for all of us if we don't recycle. Mm-hmm. But I think we're also acknowledging that the Scottish Household Recycling Charter, the commitment of the Scottish Government and COSLA to concentrate people's minds is probably the right route at this stage.
Yeah. I think other initiatives such as the deposit return system that's been talked about, that's been highlighted recently, there are sort of things that are going forward, so I think there's enough issues that will bring the balance back, and I favour we close this petition because it's I believe will achieve things another way.
Okay. So is it agreed then we close the petition, we recognise the issues that are there. Clearly it's a matter for, you know, COSLA, the Scottish Government, we would expect them to monitor and closely the effectiveness of their own charter, and it's something that could possibly be revisited. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, in that case, if we can move on to petition 1624 by Akri Jones on the definition of adultery. The final petition agenda today is petition 1624 by Akri Jones on the definition of adultery. Members will see we have a submission from the Scottish Government and a response from the petitioner. Members will recall that the petition is calling for the Divorce Scotland Act 1976 to be amended so that adultery is defined in such a way that it can be committed between people of the same sex as well as people of different sexes. The Scottish Government's submission does not support what has been called for. It does not intend to consult or legislate on this issue in the current session of Parliament and believes that the issue was sufficiently explored during the passage of the Marriage and Civil Partnership Scotland Act 2014. The petitioner considers that the Act is not human rights compliant and she considers the issue should be explored by the Scottish Law Commission. The Clerk's note explains that the Scottish Law Commission will be consulting on its 10th programme of law reform in the year ahead. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action?
I don't think adultery actually comes up anymore within divorce cases. I don't think it even comes up now.
It's not as unreasonable behaviour, does it not?
It's unreasonable behaviour. It comes under unreasonable behaviour. It doesn't stand alone anymore. I don't think.
I think the suggestion from the petitioner that it must do, and the definition of adultery is, you know, between opposite sexes, which is presumably is kind of at the heart of this. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I suppose what we need to establish is, well, and another option open to the petitioner is obviously to test it in the courts round whether it's human rights compliant, and that's not really a matter for us. Are there other means by which a marriage can be dissolved? And I think the contention is there are other means by which unreasonable behaviour can be established. And so on that basis, it's, you know, it wouldn't be discrimination, but that would be a matter for the courts. And I think the point that the government makes, which is that this was discussed as recently as 2014, yeah, would suggest that these matters were explored in the Parliament at that time and they didn't want to take this forward. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what conclusions we would... I mean, we're in a position where the Scottish Government's saying they're not going to consult or act on it. There are other options open to people in civil partnerships or equal marriages in order to be divorced, and it's very recently been debated.
I don't think we have really much further we can go with this, other than, you know, to close the petition. I don't think we can do anything with this.
Chair, you know, talk to the Scottish Law Commission once they've published their consultation and take it as an individual case themselves.
It'd be a matter for the petitioner.
Absolutely right. I think we basically essentially close the case. It's quite clear in the Scottish Government's guidance that there's no move. Okay. And they've obviously done their research in 2014.
Okay, so we're agreeing to close petition understanding order rule 15.7 on the basis that the issue raised by the petition was considered recently during the passage of the Marriage and Civil Partnership Scotland Act, and the Scottish Government has no intention to consult or legislate on the issue in the current session of the Scottish Parliament. And we're obviously able to let the petitioner know that she can, that she's able to respond to Scottish Law Commission's forthcoming consultation. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. In that case, can I thank you all for your attendance and close the meeting?